Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining today. This is the first episode for 2023, February 2023, Learn with Google. We are launching this series again that we did last year, and I think we did it the year before. It just wasn't called Learn with Google. And it's a monthly webinar, almost like a web podcast almost. It's becoming that, where we talk about all things Google. We try and focus on a theme each month. We finished off with a whole bunch of news and tips and tricks and some what's new with Google. And that's exactly what we're going to do today. And let's get into it. So today the theme is the art of designing digital lessons. We've got some goodies for you. Before we get started, just to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands upon which we meet today, wherever it is for you, we are scattered all across this wide brown land. But wherever you are, we'd like to honor the presence of the ancestors who reside in the imagination of the lands in which we live. And over on the other side of the Dutch.
I like how you say Dutch there, Chris. That's awesome. Kia ora whanau. Nga mihi nui kia koutou katoa. Kia papatua nuku tēnā koe ki te whare, tēnā koe ki te tūpuna, tēnā koe, tēnā koutou katoa, tihei mauri ora. And because we are recording this, I'd love to do a bit of a shout out to all the people who have been affected by our crazy ass flooding all over the Motu at the moment. So I know some people are doing it pretty tough over here at the moment. We've had about 500 schools disconnected from the internet. So yes, a pretty interesting time of year. So everyone, yeah,
thoughts are with you guys. All right. Oops, click this thing. As usual, this is the team who bring you these things. We're not all here today, but Chris Hart and myself and Steve is here. And I just thought we normally just put this slide up and say that's the team and we move on. But I just thought just because it's the start of the year, we just do a little I'm going to ask both Chris and Steve just very quickly, like 30 seconds or so, guys, we'll keep it quick. What did you do before you came to Google and what do you currently actually do at Google? Because I think it's black box to a lot of people. Steve, what did you do before Google?
So before Google, I was a geography and social studies teacher for 20 years. I started teaching when I was three. there you go, always get to laugh. Better crowd than last time I spoke to. So I was a geography and social studies teacher. Grew up born in Christchurch, moved north with my whānau, and did most of my schooling in Auckland. Did a lot of work around doing a bit of PD, a bit of training, worked with some cool people, doing a lot of training in different places for teachers, and went, looked for a bit more. And then the option came up to step out of the classroom and step into the Google team. And I went through the process and must have slipped in on an off day and managed to join the team 3 years ago. So it's been pretty cool. So that was my journey to Google, I guess, to get to where we are today.
And what do you actually do at Google now?
So what do I actually do at Google? So I look after anything to do with education in New Zealand, right the way from our year ones, right the way up to our tertiary providers. So I am sort of the person on the ground for Google for Education. So everything from working with our wonderful teachers and students, to our school leaders, to our service providers and our resellers, but everything around the Google ecosystem in New Zealand is me.
All right, sure. Excellent. Fantastic. Thanks, Steve. Chris Hart, in an Australian 30 seconds, get us to tell you about what you did prior to coming to Google and what you currently do there now.
I was a teacher as well. I taught French, Spanish and digital technologies for about 17 years. And then that was in the UK and then here in Australia. And then I started doing, very similar to Steve, started doing professional learning and supporting schools. And now I look after, it's officially government engagement and academic lead for Asia Pacific. So it means I get to work with lots of different governments on their education strategy and the digital transformation strategy, which is a lot of fun. And sometimes, as Chris Petra and I did on Monday, not wanting to humble brag, but we did, we ran a workshop for some amazing Indigenous students in our Sydney office, and we managed to get Winston Duke, who is from the Wakanda Forever Black Panther movies, to come in and hang out with the kids and talk to them about his journey and his career because he was filming in Sydney. So that's literally my life highlight. So that's what I currently do, is just hang out with Chris Petra and Hollywood stars, which are one and the same in many ways.
Ironically, Chris emailed me just before that and said, hey, come and hang out with Winston Duke. And I went, I have no idea who that is. Is that some guy from a government department or something? had no idea. So it was good to meet him. He was a really interesting guy. And I'm Chris Betcher. Before doing this, I was a teacher. I was an art teacher originally, and kind of drifted into digital design and multimedia and computing and computer science and stuff like that. And I've been with Fast Food for close to 30 years, I guess. And I kind of drifted out into doing more teacher training, and then somehow ended up here at Google, where my role is workspace adoption, or Google for Education adoption. So basically, I help our users learn more about what Google does and how they can use it in the classroom.
And you used to do a lot of podcasts as well, Chris. I think if you do a bit of a Google search for Chris Bitch, you'll probably see lots of podcasts with him with Sweat Back Hair and talking about the cutting edge of technology for a long time.
Yes, thanks for that, Steve. Here's our agenda for today. So we're going to be jumping in with Chris in a minute to talk about how you actually design digital lessons, because, you know, we've gone from being a face-to-face thing, and then we did a whole bunch of remote things, and now we're back in the classroom. And, like, how do you take the best of all that digital stuff and design lessons, not just because you have to because you're remote, but how do you actually take the digital stuff and think about designing, not just doing a lesson, but designing a lesson, to take advantage of that digital world. We'll talk about some back-to-school stuff that we did recently, and particularly some 15 tips stuff. Starting a new segment in this called Questions from the Classroom. We'll talk about that as we go along, and then we'll do what's new with Google and so on. So that's what's on the agenda today. Mr. Hart, I'm going to hand over to you to take us through designing digital lessons. Do you want me to stop sharing so you can share? You're muted.
Yes, please. I've just shared my screen.
Okay.
All right. Amazing. So thanks so much for coming along this afternoon. Lovely to see you here. I really appreciate taking the time out at the end of your day to hang around with us and to talk about learning. I'm actually not in presentation mode because most of this is going to be a live demo, but I will pull it up in a presentation mode for a tick. What I want us to talk about today is rethinking about what a learning design approach is when we integrate digital technologies fully. And as Betcher said, we've used technology in Australia and New Zealand for a long, long time to different levels. And then the pandemic kind of panicked and forced a lot of people who weren't comfortable with technology to start using it, and really pushed those people who use technology a lot in their education to use it in different ways. And we're now in a stage of either people like, yes, we're going to keep going with technology, or some people are even snapping back to saying, I just want it to be, you know, old school and just get back to the way things were before. But what we really want to do is to say, well, if we have the technology that's available to us, how do we deeply embed it into what we do around learning design? But we're not starting with tools, right? This is not a tools-based approach. It really is about thinking it through the whole game of learning. What does that mean when we're designing experiences for kids? So making sure that we keep relationships at the heart of what we do, that we build models of really great learning for kids, that we work as collaborative practitioners. And what I mean by that is there is a school in Doncaster in the UK called XP School, and they're basically, their motto is "We are crew." And they talk a lot about how do you make sure that kids are not passengers in their learning, they're actually crew in their learning. So if we take it as an airplane analogy, it's like, how do we make sure that the kids are deeply participating and building and supporting each other? And also, obviously, always starting with really great questions. We're going to explore what it means to build the learning in phases, and the considerations that we're really thinking about are personalization, because personalization has been the holy grail of education for decades. Like, we've talked about personalizing learning for decades, and finally some of that technology is actually catching up and enabling that. And I think some of the work that's being done, not just at Google, and, you know, in other places as well, around the use of AI machine learning driven technology to personalize learning is really exciting. It doesn't always all work all the time really well, but what it does do is start to give us a glimpse into what it means to be able to provide a really helpful guide on the side for every single student if they've got access to technology, and really starts to challenge the questions around equity. Really thinking around through differentiation for support and challenge, how do we make sure all kids are included in learning and that all kids are challenged in learning, not just engaged, so it's not just about edutainment, but really about, like, pushing kids and challenging them, and really deeply thinking about agency and feedback. What does it mean when you empower kids to be their own agent in their learning so that they have both choice and voice, but also responsibility for their learning. And what does it mean for us when we're thinking about the kinds of feedback that we give to kids? Now, the framework at any time, by the way, please interrupt with questions. Like, this is hopefully an open discussion as well. I'm just going to demo a bunch of stuff and look to unpack it with you. The framework I'm going to use is the pedagogical framework is just a phased approach. So about learning in phases. And what we're going to do is we're going to just share that and then just show some examples of how we might build some learning experiences using this. And you might call it a hook, or you might call it an engager. It sometimes gets called a bell work. And, you know, there's a lot of different words for the way that we start a lesson. The thing that annoys me most in the world when I was working in schools was starting the lesson with the role and doing like, Ryan, present. Donna, present. I mean, you can use the role in interesting ways, right? That's actually not a bad thing. And you have to do the role. But if that's the way you start learning, you wonder about why kids maybe sometimes disengage. So how do we hook them into learning right from the start? How do we engage them right from the start of the lesson with something that is either connecting to previous learning or connecting forward into the learning they're going to kind of experience in this period of learning or in this lesson? So what does that look like, and how do we make it really visible and engaging? How do we share what the outcomes and the overview of what learning is? How do we give input? And the beauty of technology is there are so many ways to have some incredible input for kids. And then how do we give them time to construct? So you'll notice that this is a constructivist model. So it's not just about a didactic kind of teacher first driven model. It really is about giving kids opportunities to construct their understanding, to demonstrate their understanding, and then really importantly, to reflect on their learning. And so that the demo is demonstrating what they have learned. The reflect is really demonstrating how they have learned. It's like that metacognition bit. It's about talking about what are the skills I've developed? How well did I collaborate? What could I do better next time to be a more effective learner? So it is in a circle, and it is a kind of a cycle. But I think what we always have to be careful with any model is that you become too constricted by it. Like, learning is a messy business, right? So it might not be that you go hook, overview, input, construct, demo, reflect. It might be that you do a hook at the start of a learning period. You flash up the overview because you've already covered it in a different session. And you skip over the input because you're going straight to a construct. And then you come back and have some more input. And then you get the kids to demo what they've learned. And then you do some more input. And then you get the kids to construct some more. So I don't want you to think that we have to work through these in a real tight kind of cycle. But they are the different phases that we can consider when we're designing learning. And the way we restructure them is the interesting bit. Now, the rest of the slideshow is really exciting because it's all blank. Now, that makes me nervous because what I'm going to try and do in 15 minutes is to build a little bit of a lesson example that we can kind of share. Now, I have an idea, and I'm just tossing up in my brain right now, is whether I just go with the idea I've got or I like say to you, what would you like me to build a lesson on? Which makes me more nervous. Does anyone want me to try and build a lesson?
You shouldn't be nervous. I remember the last time you did this in person and we got a very strange request.
We
an unexpected request.
We definitely did.
Yeah.
All right, you think about it. If you decide, actually, I really want you to build me an input activity on something else, then shout out. But what I will do is I'll start off with something about volcanoes, because although Steve is the expert in all things geography and geology and all that stuff, I love geography and geology, and I'm definitely an expert in it, but I'm going to start off with that. And what I'd love to do is get us to explore some volcanoes. Now, I need to hook the kids into a lesson. So what I'm going to do is just start off with going through a slide deck, because that's how I'm going to kind of structure and drive my lesson. And then I'm going to insert a video. And I'm going to insert a video from YouTube. And I'm going to go biggest volcano explosion. Now, I should have really checked this before. Here we go. Oh, biggest volcano. 5 monster volcano eruptions caught on camera. Now, select. It's obviously going to embed it into here. Now, as we know, using video is the lazy person's crutch. No, it's not. It's a really great, I love using video. I think it's an awesome thing. But what I want us to think about is what are the kids doing while you've got this video running? Because most of the kids some of the kids will be watching it. A lot of the kids will be thinking about something else. So I'm going to introduce this kind of resource to you, which is They're called thinking canvases. So I just have collected these over the years and put them together in this slide deck, to which I will give you also the bit.ly link, bit.ly/thinking canvas. And feel free to make a copy of this. And what you'll see is that these are just a bunch of slides. And what I've done is I've made the backgrounds like wallpaper using the slide design tool. And I'll show you how to do that in a second. And what I want to do is to make this like a little canvas where I can capture kids' thinking. So things like see, think, wonder, connect, extend, question. You'll know that these are all from the Harvard Project Zero thinking routines. But things like I taste, I smell, I touch, I see, I hear. There are things like, what are you thinking about? There is 3-2-1 bridge, which is a really nice thinking routine. But a whole bunch of them, including Googleable and ungoogleable and questions. So it was biotechnology in the Catholic faith, Chris, because it's still there. That was the lesson that we had to plan last time. It was a tricky one.
It was a tricky one.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab this slide. I'm just going to copy this slide, and I'm just going to go into a new deck, so slides.new. So can I just have are we all reasonably comfortable with Classroom, Google Classroom? Donna, you're okay. Michael, you're okay. Awesome. Brilliant. So what I'm going to do, I won't spend too much time on this, but what I'm going to do is say that this is my hook activity on volcanoes. Let's call that, and I'm just going to paste in. I'm just going to paste in and get rid of this. Okay. And then what I've done is just I've created this, and like I said, this is in the background. So if you go to View Theme Builder, you know that's how you make backgrounds on slides. So when you make a copy of the thinking canvas, you'll be able to see all of these backgrounds when you go into Theme Builder. So if you want a Venn diagram where you don't have the kids accidentally picking up the circle and moving it, then you put it in Theme Builder in the background, and then you are able to let kids do different things on top of it when you close it. So this is the Googleable, ungoogleable one will be in here somewhere. I can find it. And I've got all these different layouts on here. So let's just close Theme Builder. So what I want the kids to do is use my really high-tech post-it notes, which are just yellow squares with the drop shadow, which makes them look really kind of post-it note-y. Is I'm just going to leave those post-it notes there, and I am going to duplicate this. So duplicate slide, just right-hand click duplicate, or just if you're on your Chromebook, Control D. And let's say we've got 30 kids in the class. I might do 15 of these and get the kids to work in pairs on shared Chromebooks. So I've now got 15 of those. If I had have been sensible, what I would have done was to put a little thing here, which was your name or names on each of the slides, because then the kids can add their names to it. As you may or may not know, that you can track when people are in the in slides. If you were logged in, this would have your names on them, so you can click on Anonymous Python, it'll take you to wherever Anonymous Python is when you're logged in with it. Anyway, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that and I'm going to push it out through my geography class. So I might go to geography, I might go to my classwork, and I'm going to create and you could do this all in advance if you want. I'm going to create I could do it as a material or an assignment. I'll do it as a quick assignment, volcanoes hook. And what I could do if I wanted to is I could add in YouTube activities, so I could actually add in the YouTube video itself. But all I'm going to do for this one is to attach from Drive the hook activity I've just made. And really importantly, and I know most of you know this, is on the let's look here on this part of the screen where you've got the option to students can view file. I want the students to all be able to edit the same file, so they're all going to be in the same file being able to edit it. And then what I would do, I mean, I'm not going to mess around too much with this, but then I'm going to assign that out to kids. So as they come into the room, in I'll get them with the Chromebook, they're logging on, I've got the video running up in the front. And what they will all be doing is, right, what are the Googleable questions and the ungoogleable questions that this video about volcanoes is making me think? Like, can I Google what is the biggest explosion? How do you measure explosions? Is it megatons or something? Steve? I'm looking at you.
Cubic kilometers of material ejected.
Oh,
wow.
So, what is the biggest number of cubic kilometers of material ejected on record? That could be a Googleable question because I can probably go and find that out. The ungoogleable ones tend to be sometimes those higher order questions, sometimes a bit more about maybe empathy, like what would it feel like to be close to an explosion? Well, you can probably imagine what that feels like, but we might not be able to Google it and get the exact answers. But basically all we're trying to get the kids to do is actually generate questions rather than answers at this point. So push that as my hook activity. They're working on that for maybe 5 minutes. I'm wandering around the classes. I'm just having a cup of tea, my feet are on the desk, etc. But in reality, I'm wandering around the class. I'm kind of asking questions, checking in with kids, and settling them straight into the activity. Then, part two. Can you remember what part two is after a hook? We have our overview and outcomes. I am actually going to steal another thinking canvas to show this to you. And the thinking canvas I'm going to use for this one is around here. If I can find it. Here it is. Actually, I'll use this one, which is populated with the wrong stuff, but it will give you an idea of how you might use it. Again, what I could do is I can add this into Google Classroom. And what I tended to do when I was teaching was not to have like lots of individual slides out to kids, is I'd put this all together as a single lesson. So all the kids' activities are in one deck. So what I'm gonna do is I am gonna copy that and I'm gonna pop it, I'll just pop it in here for, too many things open, pop it in here for now. And what I wanna do is share with the kids what they're gonna learn. Oh God, keep forgetting to do that. Control V. Keep original styles. So what you've got here is a little bit, you can do it as complicated or as not complicated as you want, but I might have a self-assessment kind of learning outcomes approach rather than just saying this is what you're going to learn by the end of the lesson. We could do it as a kind of drag and drop type thing. So basically, when we're talking about the outcomes of a lesson, I'm thinking about, okay, what are the knowledge, what's the knowledge set? What are the kids going to know that they didn't know before? What's the mindset that they're going to develop? What are the kind of ways of thinking? Are they going to think like a geologist? Or maybe they're going to think like a reporter, like they're going to do a report on an earthquake. What are the skills they're using? And this is where, and certainly in the Australian, and I know in the New Zealand curriculum, we refer to complex competencies like reasoning and metacognition and generating questions and critical thinking and creative thinking. And we kind of do it, but often we don't always necessarily surface it in the outcome. So I've got some badges, and those badges, by the way, are available if you want them on the template. But I've got some badges around like what are the different skills you might be using. And finally, and sometimes we definitely forget about this, is what tools are you going to use? And I think that when we're thinking about agency for kids and giving them choice, then it's a really fantastic opportunity with technology to give them choice over tools. So this is what I want you to do. This is how I want you to do it, as in this is what I want you to come up with, this is what I want you to show me, but the way you do it is up to you, whether it's a screencast, whether it's a slide, whether it's an infographic, like I don't really care the modality as long as you're demonstrating the learning that we're looking for. And so if you create one of these for a unit of work, I mean, this is a bit of creation for a single lesson, but over a unit of work, you might create one of these. And sometimes the kids are gonna be like, I have no idea what any of this stuff is about. And they've kind of got this over here and they haven't demonstrated any of these things. Let's drag that up here as well. And as they go through the unit of work, it might be, all right, that's a personal one if they want to do their own. But yes, I do now know about this a little bit more, and I might move it down here. Still don't know about these things. And as they move through the unit, what you're hoping for is kind of this downward movement of all of these different pieces of learning as they move towards feeling quite confident in those spaces. And so, for example, one of the things which the reasons I love using slides full stop is, okay, kids will say, yes, my reasoning skills have definitely improved, but what I really want them to do is to give me some evidence. And one of the things which is a really, oh, you all know how to do it, is to insert a comment and say, what am I called in this? Actually, you know, Betcher, I'll use you. At Chris Betcher, who's my teacher. Hi, Mr. B. I have some evidence of reasoning on slide 3. And what that does is it actually sends Chris a comment to say, oh, one of the kids that wants to flag some evidence for me about their reasoning via email. So rather than you always having to go back in, we talk about giving kids responsibility over their learning, responsibility over their evidence, then this is one way we can do it. All right, input. There are a gazillion different ways to do input, whether it's a YouTube video, whether it is a website, whether it is, God forbid, an actual, you know, atlas of the an actual paper-based atlas of the world. There are so many different ways to do this input. I'm just going to leave them, right? So whatever you want to do, and I think variety is the spice of life. But when we really think about that idea of multiple exposure, I think the language is multiple exposure. So multiple exposure to the same information through different media, then this is a really great opportunity, because I know one of the things that you can do very easily is to do things like a little choice board. So let's maybe do tectonic plate video and pretend I've actually really well prepared this. And I've got a fan, oh, BBC geography, it's got to be good, right? So select, so I might have a video and I might sit that in here as a choice board. I might then insert image, let's just do a, that's the web image for tectonic plates. I'll do, that's Steve, you just keep me right here, mate. I'm assuming all of this is absolutely correct. And I might look up a website on tectonic plates.
That was okay, because that world map had New Zealand on it, so I'm happy with that one.
That's actually an improvement, right, on lots of actual historical maps and even modern maps, right? All right, so I've got a National Geographic. I've got a National Geographic article. So what I can do is just put a picture there, and I can then insert a link, and I can just link to an article. And again, I might do a link to a drive where there's just like a text piece, or I might even just have on here read page 4 in your textbook. So my input can be multiple, and I think the beauty of this is about giving kids multiple exposures, multiple choices, and different ways into the learning. And if you know, for example, Ryan, he only ever watches the bloody videos. That's all he ever does. Is you're able to have that conversation and say, well, you watch this video, let's also explore this text. So input is really anything you want it to be. Now, what I'm going to do is use, I know it's actually one of Steve's favorite tools, and it's one of Betcha's favorite tools, because we all love maps. And you know, probably all use Google Maps, but we're going to use a little mind map. Now, mind maps, if you haven't used a mind map before, I'm sure you have, is in your drive. If you go to new and then click on more, you'll find mind maps in there. I'll open it up now and I'll come back to it in a second. But what I want us to do is I want the kids to actually create a presentation based on a map. So what I've done is in my, let's get rid of that, in my assignments, what I've done is created a doc. And this is the kind of construct part. This is the kids doing the work now, is Earth on Fire is the name of our unit. And I want them to create a screencast presentation. Now, if you have Chromebooks, screencast is now super duper easy to do with the built-in screencast and the amazing technology which will allow you to have transcripts and all that kind of magic. We have been doing screencast probably for a little while as well. So Screencastify is another favorite of mine, certainly. But basically what I've got here is a task. So what I want the kids to do is to create a Google Mind Map, and then to create on one particular type of volcano, like a shield or a stratovolcano or whatever, and then create a screencast about the formation of the volcano type, also hypothesizing about the way it's distributed on the map. So what I'm going to do is I want you to inform your parents. So this is the audiences there, and we're going to use YouTube. We'd probably just use Google Drive. So it needs to be really, really clearly explained. Now, the Kiwis in the room, I'm sure, are massive fans of the solar taxonomy. It's been part of, I think, Kiwi education for a long time. I think the NCEA, is that right? NCEA was based on?
NCEA, yeah.
NCEA, like they used to use this at least.
It's modeled very, very similarly to,
So I am a huge fan of this rubric in particular, using solar taxonomy. You can build this table and actually put it directly into Classroom if you want to. You can put that rubric in there. But all I'm saying is, like, it, on your map, you have either identified a single, multiple, or you've given an explanation, or you have extra details, and your video, you know, that's what I was looking for. And then this becomes like the hand-in place for me, the hand-in zone from a teacher's perspective. Like, so you need to put your link to your video here, you need to link your script here. I've got you to do some peer critique, so I want your peer critique to be in this document. What kind, specific, and helpful critique did you get? Here's some feed forward from me. This is what I think you should do next time. And then do yourself some self-reflection. So that all sits in a single document, which is assigned to the kids as the central point of kind of the base camp for their learning for this particular task. So everything, including me putting my critique in there, the other kids putting their critique in there, just all sits in one place. So it becomes really useful. Now, what I'm going to do is show you like a super nerdy trick, which this used to be my demo slam back in the day. I'm sure I stole it from someone else, but this is the one I used to use, is to actually make a really awesome map of volcano distribution. Now, there used to be an easier way to do it, and this is the way I can do it, but it's probably, you can probably do it in different ways. But what I want is a table, volcano distribution, geolocation in a table. Could I have done colon table there, betcha? Is that the right, and Steve, is that the, anyway. You can do like a table type search. I happen to know because I did double check this earlier that the Oregon State University has a really good one. So I'll find that one. So it has this table of volcanoes, including latitude and longitude, and that's the important bit. Now it has three pages, and because I'm lazy, I'm not gonna like get all three pages. I'm just gonna copy and paste one page of this table. And so I'll just switch down here. And so I'm literally just copying that, so Control C, and then I'm going to go to sheets.new, which will give me a new spreadsheet. And I'm just going to paste this information straight into the spreadsheet. I'm going to call it volcano. All right, so I've got my information in the spreadsheet now. That's important, and because when I go back to my map, which is all about volcanoes, and remember, I want the kids to use this map as the basis of their video, using it to screencast. Is what I can do is I can import that data from the spreadsheet. So if I look at the spreadsheet, it has the volcano name, the country, the type, the latitude, longitude, and elevation. If I go back to my map and import, I can choose from Google Drive my spreadsheet. So it's fetching that information. I'm going to call each of the placemarks volcano name, and then I'm going to choose a column. I did that wrong. I'm going to choose the way I'm going to put it, which, how am I going to locate it, is latitude and longitude, and get rid of that. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to call them all by their name and finish. And like by magic, it will pull in all of that data and just pin it onto the world map there. What I'm going to do is there are a couple of rows which are a bit dodgy. I'm going to change the style. So I'm going to just turn off uniform style, and I'm going to style it by the type, because remember, we wanted them to talk about a specific type of volcano. And so what that should do in a second, yeah, it's going to give them different colors, basically. So you've got different types of volcano, will give you different colors. And as you hover over, like if you go and have a look at this one and click on it, it'll then tell you that this is the name of the volcano, the country it's in, the type it is, latitude, longitude, and then elevation. And then, well, I mean, you can go wild with this, right? So you can, in fact, edit this, and you can then put additional information in it, and there's all kinds of stuff you can do. But we're not going to do all that. What I've done is I get the kids to build their own map out like this, which is a really nice background for them to then build a screencast on. So I've only got one more bit, right, Birch? I'm nearly there. So demoing there. So the input is going to be this kind of choice table. Their construct is that they are going to make themselves a beautiful map of, I've got the wrong keyboard on. They're gonna make themselves a beautiful map of, I'll scrap that so it looks pretty. The volcanoes, and they're gonna, oh my God, Congress. And they're going to make a screencast of that, so that's their construction. So the actual demo is their screencast, it's their video, and they have in the, template there, they've got the rubric so that we can work against that. And then finally, what I need them to do is to do their reflection. So I'm just going to go back to my thinking canvas for this one. And so I've got a bunch of different reflection tools, different thinking tools. My actual favorite one, it's probably one of the simplest ones, is connect, extend, question. And so what I might do is for each of the kids is, I might not do this so that every kid can see each other's. I might just give it as an individual slide to each individual kid. But what it's going to do is get them to think around, okay, here's a summary of my new learning. So they can do the old post-it note if you want. So here's a summary of my new learning. But then really getting them to reflect on how are the ideas and information presented connected to what I already know. And, you know, that's such an important thing for kids to build connection between their current knowledge and new knowledge. Which new ideas extend and broaden or deepen my thinking? So we might get them to do a post-it note on that. And then finally, what questions or challenges does this raise in my mind, and get them to do some reflection on that. So basically, I think what we're trying to do is to take a good pedagogical model, like a strong pedagogical model, which is underpinned by things like agency, personalization. It's underpinned then by the amazing technology that we have within Workspace and indeed beyond Workspace in our Chrome and just generally in the world and on the internet, and applying that all together as if it's just a normal tool for us. And I think the biggest learning for me when we use it like this is that it just gives me such visibility into the kids' learning and the kids' progress easily, because I can just drop in the classroom, I can look at their reflections, I can look at their work, I can see all of it in one place, not having to pull it together from everywhere. All right, so that was my, I think I went over 15 minutes, but that was my 15 to 20 minutes of learning design.
Yay.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chris.
Your pleasure.
It was a New Zealand 15 minutes.
Yeah.
No, that was great. Awesome. And it's so, you make the process seem so logical and clear. And it's not complicated. But
it's complex. It's not complicated.
Complicated. Yeah, exactly right. I'm going to bring up my screen again, and thank you.
I love that everyone's found the emoji reaction as well. There's all sorts of things flying up the screen.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah. This doesn't have the crabs. No, that came across wrong. There's an internal Google version of this that has a little crab that goes across the screen. I'm just going to...
I'm glad we're not recording that. Oh, hang on.
Yeah. Oh, hang on. Yeah. All right. So awesome. So I'll just whiz through the slides. There's a lot of good stuff in there.
And Chris, those learning what's the plural of canvases? Canvas?
The thinking canvas.
The thinking canvas. You could also use them as a background and Jamboard as well, I guess, couldn't you?
Yeah, 100%. So you can just export them as a JPEG and then put them in as a background on Jamboard. Yeah.
Yeah, nice. Cool.
Yeah. And there's a link in the chat there, bit.ly/thinkingcanvas. And for anyone watching the replay who isn't seeing the chat, it's bit.ly/thinkingcanvas. And you can go there and just, you'll get a view only version of it. And because Chris is magnanimous and loves sharing, just go to the file menu, make a copy, and you've got your own. Correct? He's nodding.
Hey Chris, just thinking about I noticed our wonderful teammate Bettina dropped in after she'd finished a conversation. So maybe we can ask her to introduce herself, because I know she loves doing that so much. So
great. Bettina, just before you dropped in, we all did a little quick like 30 seconds. Keep it quick. Like, what did you do before you came to Google, and what do you currently do at Google?
Sure. So before I came to Google, I was at Dell Technologies. I was an AE there selling hardware. And then my world got turned upside down, and I came to Google and learned all of these amazing new tools. And I am now the sales lead for Australia. So, steep learning curve for me last year, but it has been fantastic because I've had these boys showing me the ropes and teaching me everything that I needed to know. So now I get to play with all of the amazing Google tools.
We have girls too, by the way.
We do, but unfortunately Kimberly is not on the call at the minute. And she's my sidekick, so I would be lost without her as well. But the lovely world of Google is very interesting. It's never a dull moment. So
that's true. We did a back to school event a couple of weeks ago. It's in the past now, so you don't have a time machine, so you can't go back to it. However, there is a link there. We did record most of the sessions, and there's a link there and a QR code-y thing. So if you did want to go back and revisit, there was like a 1-hour session where Mr. Chris Hart actually did something in that session as well. So if you like what he showed you today, you might want to go back and have a look at what Chris did in that back to school event. We also talked about some of the new things from Google, and the address is all there. Now, as part of that, we did that 1 hour session, and then we followed it up. I actually did a couple of short sessions over the next few days that I called 15 Tips in 15 Minutes. And we did one for Chrome, Drive, Classroom, and Docs. And the links are right there. It's consistent naming structure, bit.ly/15xtips. Just put the tool's name in there. What I've done with those is if you go into any of those, it's a slide deck with basically 15 slides in it, maybe a few more, top and tail. And each one of the tips actually has a short video with it. I'd like to say it's a 1 minute video. Some of them are shorter, some of them are a wee bit longer, but roughly it'll take you about 15 minutes to go through those 15 tips with the supporting videos. And there's also a YouTube playlist to support them all as well. So if you would like those, feel free to make the most of them. I think our plan is to do a few more as well on some of the other tools, just like looking at the 15 most important things maybe you should know to use some of those tools. So they are there for your dancing and listening pleasure. This is a kind of a new thing that I thought we'd include in the Learn with Googles every month. I got an email from a teacher who shall remain nameless because I said we'd be anonymous, but he wrote me this question. He said, "Hi, I've got a quick Google Classroom question. Is there a way to delete all the comments on a Google Classroom post? I have one post with 231 comments, many of which are not really appropriate for school. I started deleting them one by one, but realized that it will take ages, hoping for a shortcut." That was Mr. H from Canberra. Let me click on this sample thing. I had a couple of suggestions for this teacher. Oh, look at that. I put the little classroom thing on sample thing. I don't know if you can see that. I have the word sample there to click on, but as soon as I go near it, it turns into a link. So I'm just going to come out of there for a second and click that. I just want to show you some ideas of what the way you could do it. And what it is this sample classroom here. For example, we've got on the stream page of the classroom, we've got a class discussion there, and you can see there's a bit of a discussion. The teacher wrote something, the students were all responding, there's a whole bunch of things going on. But this one teacher, it was one student wrote something here, Walter Mellon wrote, "I think this whole thing sucks, I hate you all." That's obviously not a very appropriate comment, so we need to do something about it. Now, if there's the one comment you've got to get rid of, you can actually just click on the dots and say delete that comment. You can even mute Walter if you need to sort of take him aside and have a word to the this young man and talk about what's appropriate and what's not. So you might like to do that. But you can just delete the comment. But the question I had from Mr. H was like, what happens if there's a whole bunch of comments and you want to get rid of them? So there's a couple of things that I suggested, and I'm going to throw it over to the rest of my team and anyone in the audience who would like to throw in an opinion. What are your ideas for how you deal with this problem? Thoughts, questions? And I'll tell you, my blunt instrument thing, this is my first response to this question was, well, you know, you can come up here and you can actually just throw away the original post. So if I click on that and I delete the actual original post, it'll pop up a little link that says, well, this will delete the announcement and all the comments that go with it. It'll all be deleted. So that's one possible thing. You can just like throw everything away. And I guess if you've got 231 comments and 225 of them are terrible, you just throw them all away and bad luck for the others, right?
I guess that was my gut reaction was just to delete the whole thing and start again. You know, it's often easy to chuck the whole lot out. But I'm sure, Chris, you're going to show me a much better way than doing that.
Well, there is no way. Like we don't actually have anything in Classroom where you can go and select a whole bunch of comments and selectively throw them away. It is a matter of one by one deleting each comment, which is a bit annoying when you've got that many. Anyone got any thoughts? I have a suggestion, and I mentioned it to this teacher, and he went, that's not a bad idea. But so my thought was a little bit of digital citizenship here. This is a perfect teaching opportunity for me to say, take those kids aside. Thanks, Gillian, yeah, and use it as a learning opportunity and actually say to these kids, let's have a look at these comments. Why are they inappropriate? What makes a comment inappropriate? And then get the kids to go and delete their own comments because they still have editing rights. If you leave a comment on something, you can't delete someone else's comment, but you can delete your own. So my thought would be, well, I'd use it as that learning opportunity to talk about digital citizenship and appropriateness and living in a sort of social construct online, and then get the kids to go back through there and go, you know what, I really wish I didn't say that, and then they take it out again. Hopefully that works, but that was just a thought. And I don't know if anyone else has any other suggestions on that.
I guess it's the same as when you show, you know, when you show revision history on the up on the projector for the first time, and everyone realizes that everything they say is actually linked back to them, and the fact that everything that's said on this comment is linked back to a person. So you're right; it's using it as a learning moment is probably better than just doing a mass deletion.
Yeah, I tend to think so. And even things that are really obvious, like Walter said, "I think this sucks. I hate you all." I mean, that's pretty clearly a bad comment and that you'd want to get rid of. But, you know, Justin responded to that and said, "That's so rude. Don't be a goose." Like, that's kind of rude too. So I think it opens up a real good conversation about, you know, how you might deal with behavior in these online spaces. So anyway, that's just a couple of ideas there. So, Mr. H, if you're around.
Hey, Chris.
Yeah.
Just if you want to just jump back to your classroom, it's probably a good time to say, if we as a group thought that a mass deletion was a great thing we'd like in classroom, how could we possibly give that feedback to developers?
That's a really good point, Steve. There's a little question mark in the bottom corner here. And if you ever see something in classroom that you'd like to work differently, you can click on that question mark, say, report an issue or request a feature, and that'll pop up a little box like there you go, and you can suggest an idea for classroom. And we actually
surely no one reads those, do they? They just go into the ether, don't they?
Not for classroom. The classroom team is quite small, and they do actually read everything, and they're quite responsive. They don't always get it done quickly, but they do listen to things, and they do get things done eventually. So just some ideas there on how you might deal with that stuff. I thought what we might do, if you'd like to, and I'll get the link here and I'll put it in the chat. I created a little form earlier today. It looks like this. Oh, I should have fixed that. I will fix that. And rookie mistake. But I've got a little Google form that I'll make sure everyone has access to. And if you'd like to pose one of these questions from the classroom, we'll pick one each month and we'll sort of, you know, dissect it and pull it apart. All right, let's just talk about some of the things that are new. We've got about 10 minutes left, so not long. What's new from Google for Education that's come out in the last couple of months, really? We usually do the last 30 days, but we've had holidays and it's been a long time. So a couple of things that have come out that have been newish. First one, this just came out recently, drop-down chips in Google Sheets. You've always been able to put drop-downs in Google Sheets through a thing called data validation, but it's kind of been a bit nerdy to do it, so it's a much more simplified process. And just to show you what it looks like here, if I click on that sample, I've got a little sheet here, and like here's an example. You know, so let's say you're working on your school yearbook project and you've got a whole bunch of tasks that need to get done for the school yearbook, and so they might be assigned to certain people. So maybe Steve's doing that one, and maybe Kimberly's doing that one, Bettina's in charge of collecting that from year seven, and so on. So you can assign the tasks. That's how the drop downs work. Let me show you how you make the dropdowns. Let's say I want another column next to it, which is the status. Have we started? Is it in process? Is it finished? So what you can do is select the cells that you want to apply this to. And then now it's as simple as go and insert a dropdown, right? It used to be a data validation, all these, like no one knew what that meant. So now it's just insert a dropdown. A box will open on the side here, and then you can put in your category. So this might be not yet started. This might be started. Add another item. It might be in progress, and I don't know, completed. Like so, you can assign colors to them if you want. So, you know, if it's started, it's green. If it's in process, it's yellow. If it's completed, it's I don't know, blue. Okay, so you can do your colors, and when you say yes, done. Then you simply get those little dropdowns. So you can say that one's been started, this one is in progress, and so on. So that's a really simple way you can do this dropdowns. Brand new in Google Sheets. Like I said, you could do dropdowns, but this is a new way to do it. I think it's a much simpler way to do it. The next little thing I want to show you is, oh, by the way, what I did with this, just so you know, those dots there, FSTP, Fundamental Standard Teaching and Learning Plus. There are four editions of Google Workspace. Fundamentals is the free version, and Standard Teaching, Learning, and Plus are paid editions. But if you're in a New Zealand school, probably a good chance you're using the Plus version. A lot of schools across Australia now are using the Plus version. I can see Brian's here, Canberra Skills using the Plus version. So pretty good chance you're using the Plus version of Workspace anyway. But what I've just done is I put up in the corner of the slide here, those little dots. If the dots are colored in, then it's in your edition that you've got, okay? So that's in everything. This is a new one too, easily assigning tasks. So this is, I just showed you that drop-down list for sort of tracking the progress of something. This is another great way you can do it as well. And here's a little sample file I've got. So let's say you're, same kind of idea, you're running an excursion. You're making a list of things that need to get done for this excursion. One of the things you can do now is you can select that and apply, instead of bullet points or numbering, there's this new thing in Docs now called checklist, which you can do that. But the new thing is that you've got a little icon that comes up in front of it, and now you can actually assign that task to someone. So let's say it's Steve's job to organize the letter to the parents. What I can do is click on that, assign that task, assign that to Steve, and say, okay, that needs Steve to be done by the end of the week, okay? And I'll assign that as a task. And that then puts Steve's icon in front of it. It also drops that into Steve's task list, and it also puts it into Steve's calendar. Dated whatever date I chose there, right? And so as that gets closer to the due date, it'll actually have a reminder in the calendar that that task needs to get done. When he does that task, and he can either tick it off from the calendar or from his to-do list or from the document, no matter where he ticks it off, when he ticks it off, it will actually get ticked off in all of those places. So it's a seamless sort of thing right across the whole thing. So I'll just show you one more time how you do that again. So I'll go, so booking the bus, that might be Bettina's job. So I go there, type in the person's name. There's Bettina. I need this done by tomorrow, Bettina. And I go assign that as a task. And now that's in her task list. It's in her calendar. When she ticks it off, it ticks it off from the Google Doc as well. It's a great little new tool there for managing task assignments. All right, so that's a neat little tool. This one here, we've showed this in the past where you can create a calendar, appointment scheduling in your calendar. And if you don't recall that, I'll just real quickly open my calendar here. Oops, sorry, that one there. That one there, calendar. So if you go into your Google Calendar, like so, you can create, it used to be called appointment slots, where you could create slots that people could book into your calendar. And we changed it recently to a thing called appointment schedules. And the way it works now is if you want to say, okay, on Wednesday, this block of time here, we're having parent-teacher time during that time, you can put an appointment schedule in there, and you can say, I want a new appointment schedule for that time, and you can go and say, okay, between 12 and 3 on that Wednesday, we're gonna be able to make ourselves available. And I want to have, instead of one-hour time slots, I only want, say, 15-minute time slots. That's good. That's been there for a while. Here's the new thing. The new thing now is calendars checked for availability. If you have multiple calendars, you can actually include multiple calendars now. It used to be you could only have the one calendar. So, for example, I have some of my things happening on one calendar and some of my life happens on another calendar, and I'd be doing things in the other calendar, but it wouldn't show me as being blocked out because it could only track the one calendar. Now you can track as many calendars as you like, and they will block out the time for that, whatever you've got in any of those calendars. That's the new feature, okay? If you haven't played with scheduling, check it out. Hit that. But just be aware that the new thing is multiple calendars. There's also a new thing in Meet. And again, this is one that's gonna be hard to actually demonstrate, so I won't, I'll just tell you about it. If I was to present my slides in Meet like I'm doing right now, I actually now have the option if I was to go to, can I actually do it here? I did do that. So I'm presenting those slides. This is really hard to show you. But basically, if you've got speaker notes attached to some slides and you're presenting your slides in a Google Meet, you will see your speaker notes on the screen. Nobody else will see them. So if you're the kind of person that likes to have some notes to as you give your talk, you can now have them without it annoying everybody else in the meeting, and you'll look so professional. All right.
I think the nice thing about that, Chris, is it takes away the need for multiple screens as well. You have like kind of your presentation one, and or you try and squish everything down, it looks a bit weird. Yeah, it's really helpful.
Absolutely. And the other thing that's new in Meet is if you're using captions, which I turned this on at the start of our call today, there is now a little thing when you start the recording in Google Meet, you can turn this on here and it will record the captions. Now you can turn your captions on at any time. You might, if you look at the bottom of the screen, the little CC button, you've got closed captions. You can turn them on or off at any time for yourself. But what this does is it will actually include the captions in the recording of the video. I haven't used it yet, so we're trying this for the first time today, but it looks like it's a great idea to be able to actually include those captions with the video. And then finally, I mentioned before that I used to teach a bit of computer science, and I'd often get my kids to sort of, as they're writing their projects and stuff, I'd get them to do some sort of documentation with it. And so here's an example. That's a bad example. Can I undo that? I can undo that. Okay, bad example. I'll do this one down the bottom. If you just take a piece of code, this is Python, I think, from memory, and you put it inside a Google Doc, that's just how it looks. Like, it doesn't actually get formatted the way that code normally gets formatted. So what you can do now is if you type into a Google Doc a piece of code like JavaScript or Python or C++, you can now select that and say insert a building block, and there's a building block now called code block. So if you've got kids who are writing code, you can go, okay, this one's in Python, so I'll do that, boom, and it takes that code and it formats it correctly as a code block and is all laid out and color-coded and all the things that nerd programmers really like to have. And then there was a simpler one up the top there, you can see. So great to actually create documentation about a project you're doing where you can write up about what you've done and then say, oh, and here's the code that I used. And it actually sits in that nice little block correctly formatted. Probably not relevant to most people in this room, but if you teach computing or computer science, it's a hugely useful thing. All right, and that's about all we got from the new stuff. There's always new stuff. I only try and pick out the ones that I think are the more interesting ones, but there is always new stuff coming through. Just a reminder, you are in a webinar called Learn with Google. We're doing these every month. That was the first one, and we've got more coming up, setting up your classroom. We do a thing on Chromebooks, developing a curious mindset with search skills. Like, there's a ton of things there. If you've arrived here today via the website, you've probably already seen this list, so I won't dwell on it. But one of the things I'd like to suggest is, like, I can find the right slide, tell a friend. Like, we would love to have more people involved in this, and because I think they're useful. Wave if you think they've been useful. So, you know, tell a friend. The more people that see these, the better, even if they're just watching the replay. I think it's a good thing. And you can get that by registering.
Yeah, Chris, I think that the nice thing, sorry to interrupt there, I just wanted to reinforce what you said there, you know, that the fact that you've got this set up with this entirely new platform means that people can register and re-watch this later on. Yeah. So I know we have hundreds of people registered for this, and lots of them do watch afterwards. So yeah, feel free to share it out so people can watch it, you know, at their leisure.
Yeah. The way that works, by the way, is if you've been joining us for these for a while, you know, remember we had like a Google Slides website that we had all this stuff on. We don't do that anymore. We've moved everything over to this new platform. So after this recording is done, the recording for this will appear on the actual website. So where you join to click this today, if you go back there, the recording will simply be there as well. I have to process a few things to make that happen, but so, you know, hopefully by tomorrow it'll be there. And I'm also taking all of these things and putting them in a YouTube playlist as well. So I'm trying to make this as accessible to people as possible. And then, of course, finally, as usual, if you'd like to get a little bit of PD credit for attending today, there is a form there, bit.ly/GFE certificate. If you just go there, fill out that form, it will generate you a pretty certificate and email it directly to you straight away. And on that note, we are at time. We started a minute late. We're finishing a minute late. We're right on time. If anyone has any questions, you'll make us later, but that's okay. I'm going to stop the recording, and if anyone wants to hang around and ask a couple of questions, we will be hanging around for a few minutes to do so. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Thanks, Mr. Hart, for your input. Thanks, Steve. Thanks, Bettina. And thanks, everyone else, for being here.
Ka kite. Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, guys. Apologies. I have to jump to another call. So nice to see you all. Bye.
No worries.
Thanks, Pete.